As the Honourable Prime Minister and Dr. Chambers has alluded to, three of our cases have now tested negative two times, which means so far we've got at least a one in six mathematical version of saying that so far one in six are well and have recovered from the virus. We hope to have all of them well and recover from the virus. That is a hope of everyone in the country, and wishing those who have been sick. But certainly there's been work around making sure that they've been supported in their treatments, and we are grateful that they've now tested negative two times. What it means though is, again, I want to make it very clear, making sure that we've covered all bases, they will be again under home isolation for 14 days. And also included in this is those who have been in isolation as close contacts of the positive cases, and have tested negative a few times, two or three times, they will be discharged to home isolation also. And they will be visited by our Ministry of Health, working with other agencies such as the discipline forces, that will be ensuring that they will be at home. Also, as you have, must have heard, we've now, for those Fijians who are coming from overseas, that 28 days of isolation remains, 14 days in the government-funded designated facility. If they then test negative, they may then be taken to their home for continued home isolation without people visiting them on a daily basis. This is to ensure that we are covering all bases in terms of coronavirus and COVID-19, really because of what we are beginning to learn in our own environment. Very briefly, in terms of Tropical Cyclone Harold, our Minister of Health officials are working hard around the clock in all divisions in Fiji in terms of making sure that we reduce the sources of leptospirosis, typhoid, dengue, and diarrheal diseases. These diseases, some of their clinical manifestations are similar to some of the clinical manifestations of COVID-19. So it's very important for us that we work hand in hand with every individual to make sure that we reduce the likelihood of this being an outbreak, because we want to concentrate on the task at hand, which is focusing on COVID-19. Is there any questions for the Ministry of Health?
Going back to patient 18, I understand close contacts have been taken into isolation and casual contact tracing has begun. Can you tell us a bit more about the community, since there is no lockdown happening in Ba? Are there nearby neighbors, or was she living in an isolated home? What are we talking about in terms of your teams on the ground, and whether neighbors and parts of the community also need to be screened?
Thank you. The neighborhood has been fever screened as of yesterday. About 500 individuals have had their fevers screened. With case 18, this case is actually well beyond the 14 days of incubation period and testing softly positive, meaning, as the Honourable Prime Minister has alluded to, the likelihood that she's in the towards the end of infection with COVID-19. Because this case was well beyond the 14 days of incubation, this is also well beyond the 14 days of close contact with the family that she lives with at home. That's why we're able to test them, like we have done with the other cases, the imported cases and their close contacts that we are releasing, because they've been negative. So we've been able to test them because they're well beyond the 14 days of incubation with the case 18. And they've all tested negative so far. But nevertheless, we've taken them into isolation for the next 14 days as per protocol that we have in place.
The fact that symptoms don't appear and people start testing positive after the 14-day period, what sort of risks does that pose in terms of the government and your ministry's attempts to clamp down on any more cases or any more spread of the virus?
Thank you, Edwin. You've just answered the question, which is basically, the case 18 is well beyond 14 days. So the close contacts have been living with her well beyond 14 days. So if they were to be positive, they would have been positive by now. And that's exactly the reason why we're able to do the testing. That's actually the reason why the strategy has been the close contacts have been negative well beyond the incubation period. And then the likelihood of casual contacts being positive is very, very low. Not zero, but low. Remember also in the Fiji setting, what we are seeing is those who actually are positive to the virus or become COVID-19 patients that are through local transmission, which is receiving it in Fiji, are direct or close contacts of those who came with the virus. We haven't had any casual contacts yet in the Fiji setting being positive. So far we've done nearly 800 tests. Our strike rate is about 2.2 to 3%, which is 2.2 to 3% of those that we test actually becoming out positive. Any other questions?
Minister, you mentioned that you've already conducted 800 tests. How many people are we looking at to test? And for the testing kits, where are we acquiring it from? And since China is donating medical supplies to countries, have we sought the assistance of the Chinese government in terms of acquiring medical supplies?
In terms of testing kits, we continue to receive testing kits as they come through. As we are all aware, at the moment there is a global need for testing kits, but we also have to make sure that these testing kits are those that are recognized by WHO. So WHO give us guidance, and with their help and support, they provided some, but some of them we actually have bought ourselves. We continue to receive them on a weekly basis. We're thankful to Fiji Airways for connecting the dots in terms of making sure they're picking them up as they arrive in Sydney or in Auckland. Recently, the flight that came from the Royal Australian Air Force or Royal New Zealand Air Force brought some of the testing kits over. So we continue to receive testing kits. We have enough testing kits for the protocols that we have in place. We also have to remember that we've extended our protocols for testing from the initial phase until now. Other countries that we work with in terms of Australia, New Zealand and so forth also have extended their protocols for testing. But then remember that they have very high populations, and so they're testing more, but standardized for their population and standardized to our population, to theirs, we're testing about the same number.
So Shelvin from Fijisan, what has been the clinical strategy leading up to the recovery of these three patients in terms of medicine?
Thank you. As you're aware, also with COVID-19, there is no specific cure. There's no medicine that cures it. There is no vaccine to prevent it and no medicine to cure. So, for example, somebody comes with a boil, it's likely to be caused by a bacteria called Staphylococcus aureus. We give flucloxacillin or cloxacillin, which is the antibiotic specific for Staph aureus. With COVID-19, there is none. What does happen is they rapidly destroy the aerodigestive tract, especially the lungs, because they lodge in the back of the airway and they go down. What our clinical people are doing, you haven't seen them yet. So they are Dr. Ravi, Dr. Luke, the intensivists, Dr. Aquila, Dr. Lisa Bennett. They have a plan in terms of a guideline in terms of how they aggressively manage the individual so that they don't require a ventilator. Having said that, some of them have had symptoms that have become slightly short of breath. Some of them have developed pneumonia, but they've all become stable because of the treatment that we've provided for them. There is no magic cure. The key is to be able to support the body as it develops its immunity towards the COVID-19. And from that point of view, we're doing very well.
Is it safe to say we won't be running after the malaria drug?
No, we're not going to use the malaria drug. If you look at some of the evidence that's coming through, there's a lot of side effects from the malaria drug, including death, and we don't want that in our situation. We want to be also sure that whatever we're going to offer to Fijians, and as a responsible government, that's what we do, is we make sure that this is tested, this is actually verified, it's been peer-reviewed, it's based on evidence, and WHO says yes. Nawaliu.
Avenue, I live there from my TV. My question is with regards to your testing kits. Can you tell us what reagents are you using? Where are you getting them from? Do they cost you a lot? And do you have enough in your budget for that? And further to that, considering that our last couple of patients have been people that tested positive well after the period that we expected them to, do you not think it's prudent now to do more testings instead of your fever screening?
Yes, so going back to your first topic, we have the ability, first and foremost, we have the ability, we have a molecular lab, we have the ability to do molecular testing for COVID-19. There are many types of tests that have now all of a sudden popped up, and if you press Google and COVID-19, they will show you all types of tests. The testing that we do is testing that is WHO verified. So you got the FDA, which the Americans use, but we, and together with WHO, so we make sure that it's verified. We also have to make sure that our their system's capabilities to be able to test them using that verified test. And so we work with WHO, we work with other partners, such as the, recently we worked with the Australian government in making sure that we buy from the suppliers that are based out of Australia in terms of the testing kits, and also working with WHO in terms of the testing kits that they also supply. So we're buying some of them are supplied, but and all in all, we make sure that this is verified testing kits. It's similar to the vaccination programs that we have in place. We buy through UNICEF and it comes from Copenhagen in Denmark. There are many other companies around the world that provide immunizations for simple things such as measles, for example, but we buy from what is verified, and that is UNICEF, and they bring it from Europe. And that's how we do it, to make sure that we protect the Fijians. What was your second question?
My second question is, considering that our last two patients have been people that became symptomatic well after the incubation period we knew about, do you not think it's prudent now to do more testing instead of the fever screening?
Yes, we are doing more testing. Throughout the weekend, the Honourable Prime Minister said even just on the weekend we did more than 100 tests.
I don't mean the ones associated with confirmed positive patients. I mean just getting out into the community and doing widespread testing.
So we are also testing those who are in the community, who have a history of travel, or who are contact with somebody who's had a history of travel, irrespective of the cases that we have, and who may have symptoms. We test them.